Welcome to the Technori Podcast. I'm your host, Scott Catoon. Today's show is sponsored by ActiveCampaign. Go beyond email marketing with true automation by signing up at activecampaign.com/technori. Get your first 2 months for free on me. Today's guest, Sam Yam, CTO, co-founder of Patreon. If you are in the arts, artist, creator, podcaster, video, investor, you know Patreon. I'm a huge fan. This is like one of those top days, right? You wake up and you're like, who's on the show today? Patreon, big time. This is like when I had Superhuman on. I love having companies that I love and love to use. So this is a treat for me. For you, it's a treat to get an inside look of why they built Patreon and the whole purpose and the idea of creating scalable intimacy within communities. That's something that is nearly impossible. And it's something that YouTube and Facebook and Twitter and all these other things, whether it's for business purposes, good or for evil, have not been able to do. The algorithm basically dictates 70% plus of whatever it is you see. You wonder why you post stuff on Facebook all the time and your friends don't ever see it. It's because it doesn't feed into whatever it is the algorithm wants your friends to see. And I don't know about you, but I kind of like to talk to people who want to hear what I have to say. And I like to talk with people who I like to hear what they have to say. And that's why I use things like Patreon, because it's a community where I can bullshit my way through anything on this show all day and then go on Patreon and post something more intimate or more private that I know my select fans and friends will want to hear about. And they do that. They go there and they do that. And they also, of course, can financially support me and many others. You know, there's people on Patreon, believe it or not, spending $100 a month supporting artists. That's like $1,200, $1,500 a year just supporting people that they think deserve support. You learn a whole bunch of stuff about Patreon, how it works, why it works, how to use it. We dip a little bit into sort of like the future of media a little bit, which obviously I nerd out on. Well, Sam nerds out even more than I do because he's the co-founder of Patreon. So this is a show that I think is well worth listening to. If you enjoy this episode, you should definitely check out my conversation with Republic founder Ken Wynn. For that, just go to Spotify. I'm not sure how you got this show, but you should do that. And then also go to Spotify and follow us there because I dig Spotify. This is my conversation with the CTO and co-founder of Patreon, Sam Yam. As a creator, as a podcaster who's been doing this a long time, as a person who views myself as a media entrepreneur more than an entrepreneur itself, Patreon has always been something that has been really interesting to me. You know, I went to Medill for grad school, and I just remember sitting in these classes and thinking, how are any of you people going to make any money? Like, I remember talking to all of my professors and thinking, like, the way that you're teaching these young media, media people is not the way that we consume anymore. And I just feel like you need to have a brand. It doesn't mean you can't do like unbiased reporting for the Times, but you need to have a brand that people know who you are authentically and can trust. And there needs to be a base for you to be able to monetize your skills and your gift. And at the time I didn't see that existing. And then when I found Patreon, I was like, oh my God, this is the thing. So I'm super excited, Sam, to talk to you about Patreon and learn. I want to learn, you know, first and foremost, the platform, how it works for the audience that is unfamiliar, and then sort of why you guys decided to take this on and what were the, you know, from a CTO standpoint, like what are the technical things that have to exist that didn't exist before that make it, you know, so much easier for regular Joes and Janes to create a channel? And then we can get into like all of the intricacies and the YouTubers and all that kind of jazz. But, you know, from your vantage point, how does someone listening use Patreon?
Yeah. Great. Thanks, Scott. So effectively, we just think of ourselves as a platform for creators to get paid in sort of an ongoing, sustainable way, because there's a lot of different ways for creators to get paid. And then we get them paid primarily through the community. So people are paying them in like sort of monthly fashion in return for access to like exclusive content, access to the creator, in many cases, even access to the community itself. It's also interesting that you mentioned sort of the, your own background in media and, learning about it, through school, because I guess similarly to me, my whole background, at least before college, with like almost 15 years of like classical piano training at CMU from Pittsburgh, where I'm from. And it still is a passion of mine. But at the time, as I was like going off to college and considering what I would do in my future, it never seemed a viable approach that I could continue doing my piano studies. And so for me, it was also very personal, like realizing that, you know, there was an opportunity here to build something up that could be used for, you mentioned media folks, but really anyone that creates or has a passion for some sort of like artistic endeavor.
I want to tell you this very short story for the audience, because I think it contextualizes and reframes the value that Patreon brings to the world, to be honest. I mean, you know, I mentioned obviously the college part of the grad school part of this, you know, really, truly for me, not dissimilar from you. I was working a regular job after I graduated from undergrad, and as a vent, I mean, it was just cheaper than a shrink, really. I started a blog at Blogspot, and I would just write about, like, I don't even know, like, stuff that came to mind. Like, I would have a bad day, and I would write about, like, my experience as a young person working in kind of, like, a rich, old, white male world. And I remember, like, writing these blogs, and at the time I had signed up for Twitter. I was on Facebook before, but I was, like, not really all that active on it. And I would just tweet it out, and the stories would be anywhere from, you know, bad dates to a hard time, you know, dealing with traffic, just stupid stuff, right? And I accumulated like 10,000-ish kind of regular followers and readers of it. And I was like, what is this? Like, how is this, like, is how can I make money? Like, what am I doing? I'm not a formal writer. I'm not like, this isn't like a thing I'm trying to do. It just was fun. And then when I decided to leave my career, I was going to go to law school at Northwestern. And once I got there, I just like didn't like that. And I was like, you know what? I think I like this media thing. And I got on early with a company called Big Frame, which was like an OG in the YouTube world. And I learned about this, like, sort of, they weren't calling it influencer at the time. But I learned about this sort of like, you can make money with videos and you can make money entertaining people as just an individual. And I went to media school, Medill, after that thinking like, they'll teach me all the things that I need to know and where to go. Is it, do I work for Bloomberg? Like, what do I do? And immediately I recognized that this whole thing was broken and that there was tools that needed to happen to like completely change the game. But there still wasn't a good answer for how to make a living at it. And it doesn't have to be a living that is like your sole job, but like to make enough money to support the hobby. And
yeah,
this is the tool, and there are other tools, but this is a unique tool. And I would love to understand that moment when you're like, okay, there's an opportunity here. What do I need to do to be able to put a tool like this in the hands of a person like me?
Yeah. So the way I think about it, just as like this moment was coming up and I was thinking about Patreon, was effectively like sort of what the internet has enabled, right? And I think if you look at it, even the way you described it, it's allowed people to build up their own communities that they own themselves. And so previously, whether you were a musician or you wanted to sort of enter the industry, you might have to sign on with a third party and they'd help you with all the marketing and promotion. And that was sort of the only viable path that you could consider, you know, dealing with record labels and what have you. But nowadays, and actually for a long time now, being able to build and own your own audience is extremely empowering. And then beyond that, too, from like the audience perspective, there's sort of like all these different niches or communities or very specific things that you may have a preference or a deep interest in that you can sort of join, right, as a community. And so all this existed. You could join a community. You could build out a group of fans for yourself. But the main monetization mechanism, which is still true today, was all advertising-based. And so the goal still was like get as many eyeballs as possible, sort of in some cases watching as often as possible. And I think the paradigm that really struck me as my co-founder Jack was sort of like thinking through and pitching the idea was this notion that it's not just about eyeballs, it's about how much people care about sort of the work or the art or the or whatever creation you're putting out there, and that people are willing to pay for this stuff too. And so that was the premise on which I think Patreon was born and made a lot of sense. That you know, on YouTube you would have videos generating hundreds of thousands or even millions of views, which to put in like a different comparison is like just stadiums full of fans, right, coming to watch this particular performance. And yet oftentimes the advertising revenue would only amount to like a few hundred dollars or something, which you know is money, but it's just not it's not sustainable for like a creator's career. And so for us it was like, can we build a platform that easily allows fans to sort of connect to this creator and then support them and pay them for the work that they're outputting. You know, we believed in the idea, obviously, but I think it was still a little unproven at the time when we first launched, and this is, you know, 7 years ago. Actually, it was really interesting. The whole beginning of Patreon, we were so convicted of this idea. And yet when we went out and pitched, I think Jack, like, he knew a lot of YouTubers, so he had a list of like 50 different creators that we were going to go to. And so we had built out this platform, and then he went and pitched these 50 folks, and they all said no. And so that they weren't interested in launching with us. And so we were sort of,
it's always a good
there.
Feeling.
Like, I mean, it's like a common story you hear, right? But
only for the good ideas, I think. I swear to God, like every good idea, everyone who I like, I'm good friends with Stephen Galanis from Cameo. And I remember him coming on my show and being like, he was telling me, he's like, this is a modern day autograph. And he actually launched Cameo on our stage. Like he powered the app right there on stage. And everyone was laughing. They were like, this is what, like, what the hell is this? And I was like, this is going to be huge. Like, it just is. It's going to connect people with celebrities in a way that you can't even imagine. And everyone panned it. And it's like every great idea is usually like just slightly outside of the realm of a normal person's rational thinking.
I mean, yeah, I think that was a similar sort of mentality. Like, people were not convinced that this would make sense, or maybe they had concerns whether their community would pay them. And the thing that triggered it for us when we started growing was just Jack launching to his own audience, right, on YouTube. And when people started supporting him, like, very quickly, within the first week, he was making a few thousand dollars per song that he was releasing. I think people immediately saw that on YouTube, and then we just had creators starting to come in and just sort of organically launch on the platform. So that was the whole, you know, beginning and journey for us. It's been a lot of fun since.
Now, did I remember this right? Did this thing got kind of started on the back of podcasts? Was that, am I imagining this right, or was that just sort of my interpretation?
A podcast is certainly a very large segment for us today, across I think many different topical areas. Originally, Jack was the first person that launched on Patreon, my co-founder. And he was a musician, but he was maybe more than that, like a YouTuber. And I only draw that distinction because I think on YouTube, a lot of the times the creators have a more intimate relationship with their audience because they're able to sort of talk very authentically and genuinely and almost directly, right, yeah, to their community through these videos. And so that was, I think, the original community that sprang up. It was a lot of these different YouTubers, and that still remains a very large portion of our creators today. We podcast is a huge medium. There's a segment of web comics and folks that share maybe like inspirational messages and comics that represent a large portion of Patreon. And then there's really just, if you can think of a community around an area of creation
or
an interest group, yeah, there's usually folks that are trying to sustain that career or whatever they're working on.
So there's obviously a large number of YouTubers and podcasters alike who have a huge following and still make a ton of money on the advertising side via YouTube or sponsorship of the show or whatever. But they seem to use Patreon as sort of a double-sided piece. One, it's like, I don't want to call it an insurance policy, but there's kind of a quasi-insurance policy of like, I can still make sure that no matter what happens on Google There's still a revenue stream potentially coming in for us, but there's also a way to connect with the, you know, call it your core audience, your, you know, everyday audience in a unique and special way. Like basically anyone can click and watch one of my crazy videos or listen to my show where I talk to you. But only a select group can like have me ask you certain questions or communicate with me in a way that's, you know, very unique. Was that, do you feel like that's still the case? And if so, you know, what is sort of your take on how people use it in different ways? Like, what are the different capacities that you view it being used?
Yeah. Again, like, if you step back and you look at the other platforms that creators are using today, like Facebook and YouTube, I think for the first time, at least Instagram, Facebook announced in, like, their last quarterly earnings that Instagram, I think, generated, like, $20 billion in revenue last year.
That was a good investment by YouTube. Mark Zuckerberg.
Yeah. So it's like $15 billion. So huge amounts of money, right?
Yep.
So like the point being that these companies are like they generate their revenue all through advertising. And so the behavior that they have to facilitate is that users keep sort of engaging. At least traditionally, this is, I know there's a movement toward healthiness, but traditionally a lot of these platforms have been sort of encouraging this engagement behavior. And there's, I think the reason I bring this up is there are a lot of sort of adverse bad effects with creators. In YouTube's case, for example, there were a few moments in past years where creators would get demonetized because their content didn't align with what advertisers could advertise against. And so creators would all of a sudden see that they would get tagged and then they wouldn't be able to make any money off advertising at all. There are cases, I think, across all these platforms where, again, because it's advertising based and they effectively own your audience in many ways, you can't necessarily reach out to your entire audience. You're dependent, even when you try to send a message out to folks, on like the algorithms of these platforms and whether you will appear at all or whether your message will appear at all, you know, competing against other things or other advertisements that these platforms have to put out. And so with Patreon, the idea, and you sort of alluded to this, was always that A, like you did own your audience, and B, like the messages that you sent out will at least go out to everyone that is part of your community that is opted in. And so in that regard, like what we generally see are A, like much healthier communities, those that are people that opt in and want to be there. The conversation and the engagement is usually a lot richer a lot like very genuine too, I would say, from the audience side. And so we see things like folks that are really interested in learning more about like how the creator like behind the scenes generates their work or what is like the process behind their creativity. And we also see things where fans are effectively just there to offer almost like morale support.
Yeah.
There was, this one creator that I really like, named Simone Gertz, who sort of, her thing is she makes like shitty robots on YouTube. You may have seen some of her stuff. She was even on the Colbert show once where she has different things like a toothbrushing like helmet and just these robots that don't really work though and they make like a mess, but
great,
I know she
viewing
was,
it makes for great video.
Yeah. She was recently going through like a remission on a cancer, and one of the things she noted during this time or a remission on a tumor in particular. And one of the things she noted was that, and she said this in a video just to her community on Patreon, that there were two sort of stable things in her life right now amidst all this swirl and uncertainty. And it was her mother and then her Patreon community. And so I think that's sort of the sentiment that folks are sort of building with their community and just sort of having like a healthy, safe space.
No, I agree. I mean, I think, you know, Technori has built sort of a community in Chicago. We're getting bigger nationally amongst kind of founders and entrepreneurs. But really, as the world changes, it's like anyone who finds an interest in the kind of the tech side of things, just sort of it's more of a mindset than it is a thing. It's just sort of like you're either one of these people or you're not. And it's funny how no matter what we do or change, the community is always like, as long as you're honest about what you're trying to do, like the community's got your back. And it's right. something that I think most brands, you know, the good brands understand it and lean into it. The bad ones, less so. I think it's one of the hardships for some of the media people who have tried to make the transition to a digital world first have struggled with, because they were sort of, the brand was New York Times, the brand was whatever, whoever you wrote for or radio you were on or whatever it was. And meanwhile, these like younger kids and people who are digital native, they literally were like, these are my friends. Like I didn't make it to make money. I didn't even make it to have all the followers. I just sort of made it because I thought it was funny. And then I got a lot of followers and then I realized, oh, I've got like a career, you know, there's something I can do here. I do think that you guys have had a really interesting role, maybe unintentionally. And I also would say like Evan Williams at Medium also kind of plays, even though that's been kind of a wonky thing, we don't need to get into that, but it has played a unique role in, I think, shaping the way that people monetize and expect to monetize and expect to pay for content really going forward. I just think like there are now tiers of, yeah, you know, I'm an on again, off again consumer. Don't mind if I see ads. Big deal. Or I'll pay YouTube so I don't have to consume these ads.
And on top of just like how this content's being supported, I mean, our hope, and I think we're seeing this too, is also even the nature of the content being generated. So I think there's this
100%.
Concept that, like if you're just generating extra stuff for your community, like it can be very pure, right? There's no, you don't have to think, hey, I need to build more eyeballs. I need to think of the gotcha tagline. I think a lot of times on these other platforms, actually just yesterday, YouTube announced how like they crushed the distribution of conspiracy theories and the sort of misinformation. It was a New York Times article that I was reading through where they actually noted that 70% of the things that are being watched get generated from like YouTube's recommendation, right? And so you as a creator, if you're thinking like, hey, as I'm building stuff and releasing this content, it very much makes sense that I'm trying to build up an audience. And so I need to figure out how this algorithm on YouTube works. I need to figure out the, you know, the gotcha headlines to get more eyeballs to click on me. And so you might even unintentionally end up going down this path where like you're not even able to generate the stuff you really purely want to be creating, but instead you're thinking about the business of like audience building. And I certainly think that's fine, right? That's like a part of building out your career. But I think the notion of Patreon, your own community and folks that sort of support and believe in you regardless, allow you to in many ways like open up and just generate the stuff that you find interesting and that you're passionate about. And again, the way I would describe it is sort of like just purely your creation.
Would you say with that then that like a person using, like I'll use myself as an example. So I have, you know, this podcast, right, where I talk to people like you, and there's obviously I don't have a lot of pressure from sponsor related stuff. I mean, there might be some like market, you know, we'd like to get in this market. We like to have, you know, things that are relative to this or that. But like personally, I'm a lot more than just tech and Technori. Like I like sports, I like investing, I like entertainment, I like a lot of stuff. And so we're looking at launching sort of a show that bridges, you know, both, right? It's like, this is my Technori stuff. If you're into tech and founders, entrepreneurship, check this out. If you like sports, sports mockery, you know, whatever the case may be. Would you recommend to people like that they create their quote unquote commercial stuff and they're posting it out on YouTube, and then on Patreon, it's more of a, I would post something that's more organic, authentic, and the difference is that the community is going to watch probably all of it, but they're going to come, the real members, the real supporters are going to come on Patreon and see sort of the stuff that I do out of passion. Is that, or do people post everything across all channels?
Yeah, actually, this is exactly a behavior that we've seen a lot of creators do. There's this one creator named Alyssa Weikluse, I believe.
I love, by the way, that you know the creators on your platform. I think that's the coolest.
We have a lot. We have like over 150,000, I think, creators now making money. But in particular, just because you brought this sort of concept up of like, hey, you have a lot of out of interest outside of maybe what you're known for, right?
Yep.
And so this creator is actually sort of like a metal sort of hard rock musician. And yet she also has a deep interest in sort of sharing poetry. And I think she does a lot of painting and other artwork. And that's what her Patreon is about. And so it allows her, like, beyond, you know, how maybe many fans see her with her rock stuff, to express herself in ways that I think she really believes is true to her core. And I think her community also really loves just getting to know her a lot deeper in that regard. So we see this across a bunch of creators, because I think this is just natural too. If you're creative, sometimes that spans a very broad set of, like, outlets or different interests. And I think, again, now that the internet allows you to connect directly with community, people are deeply interested in sort of understanding, like, all the aspects of you, or maybe, like, how you think in order to get to a place where you are who you are, and then in this case doing, like, metal rock band stuff, because they probably draw parallels to their own life and they wonder what is. I think this is the other thing going on, and you see this maybe in, like, platforms like TikTok and other, where people are sort of, they all are creators too, right? Even your community of fans are themselves creators, and they want to make things, and they want to, in some sense, like, have an audience and community around themselves too. And so there's this notion that everyone is learning from each other and looking up to each other. And so, yeah, like, these communities are merging and supporting one another, and they want to see all the aspects of different creators.
It's so funny, like, the way that I frame this, like, honestly, like, in my stuff, excuse me, in my show, I do feel sometimes a lack of inspiration in what I'm doing. There'll be times where it's like, you know, you're, like, mailing it in, right? You're just like, this is not all the way what I want. Like, this wasn't my intention. I wanted this to be a fun show where I could share and be honest and say whatever. But then for whatever reasons, you find yourself holding back. And I think that, to your point before about being on, whether it's YouTube or whatever, where you're basically leaning into the business, you're trying to make sure that you're creating clickbait stuff that people will dig so that you can get your click. But you know in your heart that's not what this was supposed to be. I think that we are getting to a point, and I think you guys are a huge part of this. And this is what I was referring to before with regard to Medium and what Evan Williams has done. The click and then disregard nature of content, the 8,000, I think I had this article, what was it? A million digital impressions were fed in Illinois in, like, just the last day. Like, of just, like, just across whatever. It was, like, one platform. It was like, it's a ton. The point is, there's a ton of stuff going across. Yeah. And if the content is not inspired, or if you look at, like, the launch of Quibi, where we're talking about, like, very short form art, yep, if it is not packed and inspired and authentic, I don't think people are going to keep clicking on it. And if they are, they're not, the ad impressions will just be worthless. And I think you guys are pushing the needle to a place where people are retreating to group chats, to local communities, to places where they want to consume, whether it's 1 minute or 90 minutes of this one thing, because it's real. And that the ad value, if you were going to talk about from a monetization branding side, is actually going to be start being measured based on the amount of time that you spent on it, and rather than how many impressions were fed during it. Because we have like run the line has run. You know, the Reddit co-founder Alexis Ohanian talks about this all the time. Like, our ADDDD has made it to where, like, the ad world has to adapt, and they just don't know what to do.
Alex is actually one of our investors, and he's been super supportive of us as we've been growing. But I certainly agree with you. I think what's going to continue to matter more and more is sort of the depth of care of people around the content that you're generating. There, of course, is this notion that I think many folks are familiar with around, like, artistry and creation requiring only 1,000 true fans, and then you can make a living out of it. There was recently an article that came out of the investment firm Andreessen Horowitz about 100 true fans now, which is, like, what we're seeing is sort of people getting, again, deeper, right? Like, the depth of care and then also being willing to sort of support in a much greater way the things that they care about. And so I think some of the stats that came out of there that we helped share too was that in just the past like 2 years, we've seen our average pledge amounts increase over 20%. And even folks that are paying more than $100 a month. So these are people supporting other creators by paying like over $1,000, over $1,200 a year. That also has grown, that proportion of people, by like 21%. And so I think already, as time is going on, as people are engaging more deeply with the creators and the sort of content that they care deeply about, there's going to be a deeper relationship with these folks too, and one where they're really willing to help support them in their career.
It's honestly, it's so true. It's so funny. Also, I have to say, Alexis followed me on Twitter the other day, and it was like, I was so excited and elated. My wife loves him because of the Serena piece, and I love him because I think he's brilliant. I took a screenshot of it. I was so excited. So if you talk to him, tell him that.
Great.
But but as an aside of this, on the business side of this, you know, I talk to brands all the time, and I tried to make this argument in the early going out of necessity, right? Because I had a show with no followers. I just started the show. And I would tell the brand, like, you know, they would say, oh, how many ad impressions do you feed? How many clicks do you have? How many subscribers? And I'm, you know, the numbers were garbage. And so I'm like, whatever, it's this. And they literally would be like, oh, we're not going to advertise. We only advertise in this like size and whatever. And I was like, would you rather pay this amount of money to reach 100,000 people who do not care about your brand? They do not do anything that I tell them. They do not care. They're just listening because they had nothing else to do. Or would you rather advertise with somebody who has 100 extremely loyal people who look to them to shape their decisions daily? I would take the 100 over 100,000 every single day. And it's
and
now
I think
coming
this is
around.
Like the lack of savviness in the industry, like previously. Although, again, I think everything sort of everyone's getting a little bit smarter, right?
Well, they have to. They're running out of money.
Yeah, right.
Very cool. Well, listen, this is a really, I think, just an awesome platform. It's really cool to talk to you and learn more about sort of the origin of it. You know, at the end of the day, you guys start this thing with a dream, and that dream is a vision that will ultimately just change and pivot this way and that way to try to, you know, stay not only, you know, from a business standpoint, stay up, but also to sort of amend to the way that media is changing, and media is changing as faster than any industry in the world right now. What do you think is the thing that you guys have to continue to focus on and lean into? Where do you see this going in the next, you know, year or two or three?
Yeah. One of the big areas that we're focusing on, and you know, I've talked about this a bunch already, is just how the communities around these creators, like, how can we continue supporting them? And so we've built out, you know, some initial tooling, and there's a lot of other tools available on the web that allow creators to, sometimes I describe this as like scalable intimacy, where they can interact and give access to themselves, to their community, but in a way that isn't like extremely distracting from their, what they actually care about, from their work. Right. And so for us, a lot of what we want to continue building are tools that make this very easy. So, allowing, you know, your community to ask you questions, but in a way where you don't have to answer all of them, maybe, they can pull together and surface the ones that are maybe most relevant or most interesting, for you to deal with, allowing you to, on the fly, maybe setting up, after you release a new piece of content, maybe you can set up a quick live session with your community to sort of, again, explain like the creativity behind your process in making this most recent work, which, you know, your community oftentimes really cares about. So, like, for us, it's about building more of this almost like human-to-human connection, which we sort of see contrast against this notion of, like, how platforms work today, where they're, you know, there's this notion of like the algorithm, or like folks getting radicalized by an algorithm, leading up to like this funnel down to either like radicalization or extremism. We want to be continuing to promote this notion of like healthy communities from both from like people in the community to like other people in the community, as well as from like the creator to the community.
I love it. This is awesome. Thank you so much. Obviously, people can download the Patreon app on all things and check it out.
Yeah.
I appreciate you taking the time.
Thanks, Scott.
All right. You can follow us at Technori or follow me at Katoon to invest in featured startups or apply to pitch on the Startup Showcase live on WGN Radio. Saturdays from noon to 1 p.m. Go to technori.com. Boom, that's a wrap.